Christ living under my bride.
Welcome to the club.
There's going to be a raging fire with the breath of God breathing upon it. And as he beats upon that fire, an instrument
shall raise up out of that fire.
Spiritual, anointed, living truth. It's one thing to hear the word. It's another thing to be under the presence of God and to be on the fire of the Holy Ghost and to know that you know that the word that's coming forth is from the throne room.
It is time to be a royal priesthood and a holy nation. It is time to be the sons and daughters of a living God. It's time for the roar of the lion to be restored in God's name.
God bless you and welcome to Revival for Christ Club International Ministries. We're so glad to have you with us today on the mighty CFAN. I'm Chief Apostle Timothy Vanover. This is my lovely wife, Apostle Hello. Jay Vanover. And we're excited because today is a very, very special day. Today represents 100 programs that we've had on CFAN. Let's give them a wonderful praise. Amen. 100 programs. And we're very excited and able to touch and reach a lot of people and hopefully encourage and help people and hopefully encourage and help you. I'll tell you what, if you're someone out there right now that needs prayer in your life, I want you to put your hand towards the screen and we're going to pray with you right now. And I'm going to believe God is going to touch you. God is going to, not me, not Brother Vanover, but the Lord. Understand something. When Jenny and I come on here, we're not trying to tell you how great we are because we're people. We make mistakes. We're not great. But we're here to tell you how great the Lord is, and that you can have a relationship Amen. With him, and he'll help you through every storm of life. Amen? Dear Heavenly Father, God, right now, in the name of Jesus, by the power of the Holy Ghost and by the anointing of a living God, I ask you to reach across this screen right now. God, those that are putting their hand out, those that are setting their hand out right now, activating their faith, touch them, God, from the top of their head to the sole of their feet. Release the anointing of a living God. Devil, you are a liar. And Father, I take authority over you. I bind and rebuke every element that would come against my brother or sister that's listening right now. God, if they need a touch in their finances, open up the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing they will not have room enough to contain. God, if they need a healing in their body, Father, right now, pour out the balm of Gilead and bring healing. In Jesus' mighty and powerful name we pray. And the church said, Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I'm excited.
I am too. I cannot believe it's our 100th episode, but I am so grateful that we've had the opportunity to share Christ with you. Yes, and having amen. Said that, I want to share a scripture this morning. Please, so this has been on my heart, and I've been praying about our worship time and our praise time yes. and how any of us could at any moment just say, well, bless the name of Jesus. But God wants more than that from you and from
yes,
me.
Amen.
Word of God says in John 4:24, our God is a spirit.
Yes.
And they that worship him must worship him
in spirit
and in truth. And so this is what I want to share with you. It is important that you allow the Holy Ghost of God to have complete yes. full liberty. Yes. Let the Spirit of God bring you into that intimate worship by manifesting Holy Ghost tongues
yes, God.
Daily. And I promise you, you will feel better as a child of God.
Yes, amen. Amen. That's so true. You know, also celebrating the 100th episode, today is also Mother's Day.
Yes.
So we want to say a very happy Mother's Day to you. We actually, when this comes to you, we actually will be in Truman, Arkansas on Mother's Day. But we want to wish you a very happy Mother's Day. If you're a mother out there today, thank you so much for the love and compassion and care that you've given to your children. We appreciate all of the mothers on this beautiful Mother's Day. You know, I was very blessed. I had a pretty cool mom.
You had a wonderful mother, and she was actually my best friend.
Yeah, and your mentor.
And my personal mentor. And I have to mention, she's our Rose of Sharon, Vanover.
Amen. I just want to say my mother was a wonderful woman. I'm so grateful. My mother wasn't a wealthy lady or a lady with a lot of wealth. My mother was a woman who passed on me something even more important. She gave me a heritage. She gave me a Amen. Spiritual heritage. Amen. And for that, I am greatly, greatly thankful.
Amen.
And I appreciate that so much. I thank her for sharing her faith with me and giving me that heritage. You know, my mom was a person that She was a prayer warrior. She was a minister, a preacher, a teacher for over 40 years. She preached and taught. And in our church, she was a wonderful, wonderful mother of the church, anointed. I'm so thankful that I had the opportunity to have Sharon Vanover as my mother.
You know, and she was one of those godly women that when she walks in the room, you feel the fragrance of anointing. And I can't say that about very many people, but I could say that about your mother.
Yes, yes, amen. You know, the other thing about my mom that I always loved, my mom was not very, my mother was never lifted herself above others or thought of herself as better than anybody else. My mother always believed that we are all the children of God and that we all need that love and compassion to be what God's called us to be.
Amen.
Well, I'll tell you what, sit back and relax for Mother's Day. We got something real special for you right now. Please welcome our praise team. And this is a
mountains are still being moved. And strongholds are still being loosed. And God, we believe it. Oh, yes, we can see that wonders are still what you do. Your bodies are still being raised, and giants are still being slain. Oh God, we believe it. Yes, we can see that the wonders are still what you do. We are here for you. Come and you
praise the Lord. I hope that was a blessing to you. You know, Jenny, I believe that more than anything else right now, that God is getting ready to bring such a powerful, dynamic, and powerful move in His church like we've never seen before. I believe it's going to come through you. I believe it's going to come through me. I believe it's going to come through every man, woman, and child that is willing to surrender to the will of God, willing to surrender to His purpose and His plan. Now, you know, Jenny, one of the things I think that we as Christians now, I think this is something the Lord's really been speaking to me a lot in my spirit. I think there needs to be a repurifying of Christianity. And what I mean by that is getting back to the very basis, getting back to what that word says. And, you know, because we've come to a place now where the desires and the hungers of the Christians differ nothing from the world. And if your desires and your hunger differ nothing from the world, then you need to check the soundness of your faith. Because the Bible says in 1 John not to love the world or the things of the world. It says if you do love the world, the love of God is not in you. And then I think one of the easiest scriptures of all, to see God's opinion, see God's perspective on the desire for wealth and the desire for these things of the world. Look what He says. They that suppose that gain is godliness, from such withdraw yourself. He said they are men of perverse disputings. Absent of the truth, they do not know the truth. And that's why they don't know it. Because they're focused on raising the funds and not raising the spiritual hearts of God's
people. Well, and having said that, there's a message that you spoke during our April celebration, 37th, uh-huh. April celebration revival. And this is an amazing message because the focus God gave you is on the spiritual, yes, for the people of God. And you talk about how do we receive 100% manifold wisdom of God. We hunger and we dive down into the anointed revelation of God. And so I don't want to hold anyone back right now. Cloud Manifestation, part one.
Well, praise the Lord. I told him, I said, man, I said, got great preaching on Sunday, got great preaching on Monday. Tuesday was great. We just call that a revival move on down the road. It's been great. But I'm very privileged with the honor and privilege to get to share with you the Word of God. There's probably nothing means more to me in my entire life than sharing the Word of God. I love His Word. I love His Spirit. I love His anointing. And Him and I had a really great time today, so I really enjoy that as well. So praise the Lord. We're talking, as you know, this particular April celebration, we have told you, there are no Christian superstars. And don't get this wrong, it ain't because we can't afford them. If we wanted to get some, we could get some. We just decided not to get any. Amen. Praise God. We've had some pretty good stars in here throughout the years. I give you a who's who. Everybody's been in here. Amen. It'd be easier to give you the list of who's not been in here than the ones that have been in here. Amen. But during this revival, we wanted the focus, the attention to be on Jesus Christ. We wanted the focus and the attention to be led by the anointing and the Spirit of God. So when I assembled together the speakers for this conference, I said, I don't want anybody that's arrogant. I don't want anybody that's proud. I don't want anybody that's got an agenda. I don't want anybody out here trying to build their own ministry. I want men and women of God who are ready to bring their flesh under subjection and allow the Spirit, the anointing, and the power of God to be manifested in them. And that's why I said, no superstars, just the bright and the morning star. And His name is Jesus. And He shines alive in each and every one of us. Amen? Well, we told you that the theme for this revival is a manifestation. The manifestation. And boy, we've heard some good messages thus far on the manifestation. I'm going to try to approach this tonight the way the Lord showed it to me in a little different manner, okay? One of the most important things for you to understand about manifestation is that it is the most complete and full relationship that you can have with God. It's when you yield in full submission to your Heavenly Father. And this is the thing. We say we sacrifice. We say we surrender. Some of us say we're living sacrifices, but some of us are still holding on to elements of our flesh and elements of our carnality. If you want the manifestation of the Lord Jesus Christ to come alive in your life, you've got to understand the completeness of it. You've got to understand that you must submit completely and say, God, not my will, but your will be done. God, not what I want, but what you want, Father. That's what has to be prayed. Amen? Okay, some people say, I think it was Apostle Chuck the other night had a definition, and I think Sandra said something about it. Maybe Jenny, they all had a little thing they told you about the manifestation. Well, here's what God told me about the manifestation. He said the manifestation is an outward action declaring the transformation of the heart and the renewing of the mind. Can you say amen? So he told me the manifestation is action. It's an outward action. It's not something you hide in a corner, not something you hide in a closet. It's an outward action where people can see the image, the nature, and the personality of Jesus Christ operating in your life, in the things you do, in the things you say, and the way you live your life. Amen? Now let's go on. When you experience true transformation, you've got to put some spiritual elements into operation. Amen? Here's what the Lord showed me. When we experience true manifestation, the spiritual principles and his revelational truths are applied inwardly. Are you listening now? Come on, let's listen one more time. He said, if you want true manifestation, you have to understand that the spiritual principles which are presented by the Word and by the Spirit of God, those revelational truths that God brings, must be applied inwardly, spiritually. And once they have been applied, we then bring our flesh under subjection so that the Spirit and anointing of God can activate those powerful godly elements. Something I want you to understand. When you're in your flesh, ain't no godly elements getting activated. Come on, y'all ain't hearing me. You got to bring the flesh under subjection. So I tell you, I love you to death, but there are some of you, the devil comes and fights, and you give up. You don't fight. Honey, when the devil comes and tells you something, don't you know the minute that he said it, he's a liar? Don't you know he's a liar and the father of it? The minute that he said it, he's a liar. But you don't fight him. He comes to you and says, oh, sister so-and-so, you probably got cancer. Yeah, I probably do. That's it. He didn't fight. He meant to fight you. Why don't you do this instead? When he comes to you, I can't say, no, I don't. I'm a child of the King covered by the blood of Jesus Christ. And even if I got it, it can be eradicated by the power, the anointing, and the authority of a living God. I bind you in the name of Jesus. How often do you do that? Or how often do you just listen to the devil and do whatever the devil says? Well, you're not any good at this. You're not any good at that. You ain't doing nothing right for Jesus. Jesus is not going to use you. Why you listen to all that? Don't you know the minute he told you that you were not any good at it, you should have turned and said, woo, thank you, Jesus. That means I'm great at it. Praise God, that means I'm great at it. If you told me I wasn't no good at it, I'm great at it. If you tell me I'm going to die, it means I'm going to live. How awesome. You think God would come and torture you with death? God's not going to do that. God's not going to come and say, oh yeah, you're going to die tonight at 5 o'clock. He wouldn't tell you. He would just show up. He wouldn't tell you. He'd just be there and say, hey. You're like, wow, you look like Jesus. I am. But Jesus, well, you're not dead. You're alive. Forevermore. Come on, you're not dead, you're alive forevermore. See, honey, let me tell you something. The biggest thing a Christian don't have to worry about is death. Death is the last thing that should be on your mind. And when the devil tries to bring that to you, you need to understand something. When you're trying to be tormented with death, that's exactly what it is. It's torment, and it's from the devil. And the minute the devil starts going with that nonsense, you need to rise up in the anointing of the Spirit of God and say, I bind that attitude of death. I bind that spirit of death, and I speak life in the name of Jesus Christ. See, honey, the world thinks you're going to die because they don't know who your physician is. Come on, they don't know who you got on your side. Amen? Praise the Lord. Now, when we bring our flesh under subjection, the Spirit and the anointing can activate those powerful godly elements in us. And here's what the Lord told me. It releases
in us the spiritual capacity to outwardly manifest those truths. And here's the part that blew me away. So listen, it releases your spiritual capability to outwardly manifest those truths, presenting, oh, I love this, presenting an active and operational image of Jesus Christ in all you do. Honey, are you listening? Are you listening to what he's saying here? He said, I want you to know that that image and that nature of Jesus Christ is in you. It is time to allow the Spirit, the anointing and the power of God to bring life to those godly principles. Bring your flesh under subjection and watch God give you the capability, brother. You're going to have capability. Come on, say it, but I got capability. I got spiritual capability. I get spiritual capability. I can manifest. I can manifest. What are you waiting for, Pastor? Don't you want to manifest? Come on, manifest. Manifest. Let that spiritual capability come on. Manifest spiritual capability. We need some spiritual capability. Woo! Praise the Lord, he's going to get ugly up here tonight. It's liable to get ugly. Let's go. Understand something. Your flesh is a blocker. It is a relationship blocker to God. When you get in your flesh, you block a receptivity. You block the ability to receive instruction. You block the ability to be able to receive what God is wanting to bring alive in your life. Amen? Now, the flesh profits what? I'm sorry, the flesh profits what? Would you agree with me that the flesh is unable to put us into a divine, reactive relationship with Jesus Christ? We say the flesh can't do that. I say the flesh can't. Flesh can't do that. So the flesh profits nothing. It is unable to put us into a deep, profound relationship with God. The Bible says our God is holy. If we are going to have a real, powerful, and productive relationship with him, we must use the spiritual tools which he has put into us to put us in the prime position of relationship. Oh, come on, you ain't hearing me tonight. Can you say tonight, you're in prime position of relationship? Are you in the prime position of relationship, or are you hindered tonight? Have you given refuge to your flesh? Have you given solitude to your sin? Have you allowed the world to be an influence on you? Or are you rising up and allowing their spiritual elements, those spiritual things in you, to come alive and put you in the proper spiritual position? And let's consider this just a minute. You guys have heard me say this before, but I believe it bears repeating in this particular passage. He said, he is holy. Is that right? Yes or no? How many in this room believe God is holy? I believe God is holy. But what else did he say? He told you to do something. Be ye what? I'm sorry. Be ye what? Be ye what? Be ye what? Holy as he is what? Holy. Okay. So we need the elements that will make us holy. We need elements that will put us into a relationship and position of holiness with him. Right? Isn't it funny that he didn't even hide what they were? Isn't it funny he didn't even make it hard? He's holy, right? Be holy as he is holy, right? Two things. Holy Bible. Holy Ghost. Oh, come on. Y'all didn't hear me. Holy Bible. Holy Ghost. See, if you want to be holy as he's holy, you got to get the word of God to be more than just words on a page. You've got to get the word of God rooted and established in your kingdom of God to come alive in you. And you need the Holy Ghost to give that word of God an engine so it can move you to your destiny. Oh, come on, y'all ain't hearing me. Without the Holy Ghost, you just got a car with no engine. It looks good. It's pretty. You can get out there and wax it every day, but you can't take it 2 inches down the road. It ain't unless you push it. It ain't going nowhere. Honey, when you get the Holy Ghost in you, oh, man. When you get the Holy Ghost in you, you're not just polishing a car without a motor. Honey, you're not just polishing something that's not real. Honey, when the Holy Ghost gets inside of you, it electrifies, illuminates, activates, and releases that word of God to do exactly what it was intended to do, to do exactly what it was called to do. Exactly. I'm in trouble. I haven't got to my first scripture yet. The Lord told me, when you use the Holy Bible and you use the Holy Ghost, together in perfect measure, they bring you, oh Lord, they bring you to a holy state. Come on, y'all ain't listening to me. When you get to that point where you're actively using the word, and you're actively using the Holy Ghost together in perfect measure. As you do that in perfect measure, the holiness of the Word combined with the holiness of the Holy Ghost puts you into a state of holiness where God can now look upon you. God can now come in and sup with you. God can sit down with you. You can meditate on His wisdom and knowledge. And it's not yours anymore. It provides us the necessary position to truly fellowship with our Heavenly Father. Honey, think about this for just a second. Get over this. Think about it. If He is holy and He wants you to be holy as He is holy, and you come in with your flesh, that's not holy. So if you come in with your flesh, He can't fellowship with you. He can't sit down and sup with you because you've got an element of corruption. You've got an element called flesh. But when you begin to activate the Holy Bible, and you begin to activate the Holy Ghost, something begins to happen. Huh? Something begins to take place. Then all of a sudden, when you step into that chamber, you're not stepping in your own wisdom. You're not stepping in your own knowledge, but you're stepping by the power and the anointing of God. Okay, we got to get going here. Praise the Lord. That is my opening comments on this message. Praise God. Let's go ahead and get into work. Go with me to Ephesians. We're gonna do something really different here. Lord willing, and I can get there before the night's over. In the discussion of manifestation and the understanding of what true manifestation is, and the understanding of how to bring that manifestation to the forefront, it seemed to me to make sense to use an event in the Bible where God manifested Himself. Where He manifested Himself, there was no denying that it was God. So when I began to look in the Bible and begin to think about that, one particular event came to mind. Cecil D. DeMille liked this event, so much so that he hired Charlton Heston and gave him a stick. Honey, I'm talking about the Red Sea. I'm talking about that Red Sea experience. When God rolled back the waters of the mighty Red Sea. Honey, you going to tell me that wasn't a manifestation? You tell me God wasn't manifesting Himself? The greatest army on the planet, the army of Egypt, shook and trembled at the manifestation of our God. Amen. Going before we do that, I want you to go to Ephesians. We're going to talk about something very important here we need to talk about. Go meet to Ephesians. Praise the Lord. God is so good. Okay, Ephesians. Thank you, Jesus. Ephesians, the third chapter. Okay, Ephesians 3. I'm going to start reading in the very first verse. Ephesians 3 and 1. For this cause I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, to you Gentiles. If you have heard of the dispensation of grace of God, which is given me to you word, how that by revelation He made known unto me the mystery, as I wrote afore in a few words, whereby when ye read, you may understand my knowledge in what? I'm sorry, the mystery of what? Tonight, you're going to learn what the mystery of Christ is. What is the mystery of Christ? What is that mystery that Paul's talking about? Let's go on and look what it says. He goes on and says, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of man, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by what? By the Spirit. That the Gentiles should be fellow heirs of the same body and partakers of the promise of Jesus by the gospel. Wherefore I was made a minister according to the gift of grace of God given unto me by the effectual working of his power. Unto me who is less than and least of all the saints, in this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world has been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. To the intent that now unto principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God, according to the eternal purpose which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access and confidence by what? By our faith in him. Now, I want to explain this to you, and I'm going to lay this out here. Stay with me. The mystery, according to the scholars, according to the Bible scholars, the mystery that Paul was speaking about was that the Gentiles would be included in the spiritual heritage. That's what the scholars are saying. The scholars are saying the mystery was that nobody knew the Gentiles were going to be included. And I want you to look at this again. I don't think that's what he's talking about. I don't think that's what he's saying. Because look what he says up here. He goes up here and says, how that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery, as I wrote afore in a few words, whereby when ye read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of who? In the mystery of who? I'm sorry, in the mystery of who? In the mystery of Christ. He's not talking about the mystery of the congregation. He's not talking about the mystery of the tribe. He said, I'm talking to you about the mystery of Christ. He said, I'm talking to you about something that has been hid since the world began. But now is it made manifest unto his apostles and prophets by the Spirit of God. Now I want you to look at something. It is made known to them by the what? I'm sorry, by what? By what? Okay, now stop for a minute. Think about this. If it is revealed to him, Daryl, by the Spirit, why would the Spirit care whether you were a Jew or a Gentile? And why would the mystery concern itself with your genealogy? Why would the question concern itself with where you came from? Wait just a minute. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Paul said there's neither male nor female, nor bond nor free, nor Jew nor Greek, but we are all one in Christ Jesus. So what makes you think the Holy Ghost is interested in showing a mystery to Paul that has nothing to do with Christ? It has to do with their legalism, their ceremonialism, their religion. We're Jews and you're not. We're Jews and we're God's special people, and ain't you Gentiles the devils, y'all sinners, you're going down. What they didn't realize is that when Jesus came on the scene, when Jesus came in to carry out his mission and his assignment, we stopped being Jews. We stopped being Gentiles. We stop being black. We stop being white. Y'all ain't listening to me. We stop being Italian. We stop being Irish. We stop being, oh, you hear me? We stop being that, because now Jesus Christ has become, Jesus Christ is the new personality. Oh, you're not kidding me. Jesus Christ is the personality. So, Pastor, I want you to tell me. I want you to tell me something. I want you to tell me something. Is Jesus Christ a Jew? I'm not saying what he was. What is he? Is he a Jew? Is he a Gentile? I'm sorry, is he a Pharisee?
No.
Is he a scribe?
No.
What is Jesus? He is the Son of the living God. And brother, he didn't come down here to just save one group of people. He didn't come down here just to deliver one. He came to deliver the world. He came to deliver everybody. He came to deliver you. So, when Paul's talking about his mystery, brother, talking about the Gentiles being included in the equation, you even see what he says. I like what he says. He even makes it a little more clear. Look what he says. He says, whereby when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ. He didn't say it was a mystery about the body. It was a mystery about the tribe. It was a mystery about genealogy. It was a mystery about inheritance. He didn't say any of that. He said it's the mystery of Jesus Christ. So, what is the mystery of Jesus Christ? What is that mystery? What is the mystery that Paul knew that had been hid since the world began, but is now made manifest? What is that wonderful thing that he knew? Let's go and look what he says. Wherefore I made a minister according to the gift of grace of God given to me by the effectual working of his power. Unto me who am less than all those in the saints, this grace was given that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. And to make how many men? I'm sorry, how many? To make all men to see what is the fellowship of the what? Okay, now wait a minute. If the mystery is the Gentiles, then what would the fellowship of the mystery be? He said the fellowship of the mystery. He also calls it, he says, I understand my knowledge in the mystery of who? Mystery of who? Christ. This is a mystery concerning Jesus Christ. This is a mystery that is about Jesus Christ. This is a mystery that's going to give you a new perspective. This is a mystery that's going to open up your understanding. This is a mystery which was hid since the world began, but is now made manifest. Now, let's go on for just a minute. Amen? Praise the Lord. Go on for just a minute. I've got to read this one part. Okay. To the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church the what? I'm sorry, the what? I'm sorry, the what? In the Amplified, it says the purpose is that through the church, the complicated, many-sided wisdom of God and all of its infinite variety and innumerable aspects might now be made known unto the angelic rulers and authorities and principalities and powers in the heavenly places. Now, thank you, Jesus. Now, I want you to think about this for just a minute. I want you to think about what he just said. He said this to the intent now that principalities and powers in heavenly places might know, be known by the church, the manifold wisdom of God. And in the Amplified, we read that's a many-sided wisdom, lots of knowledge. So question for you. How do you get that wisdom? Do you study for it? Do you go to school for it? How do you get it? First of all, there's only one person that can give it to you. And that one person only operates through the Holy Ghost. So how are you going to get it without the Holy Ghost? How are you going to get it without knowing the person who operates through the Holy Ghost? Right? How are we going to get it? I want you to look. How are we going to get it? He goes on and says, according to the eternal purpose, which he purposed in who? Christ who? And look at what he says at the end. In whom we have boldness and access with confidence by faith in him. I want you to understand something. I want you to comprehend something. As you take those two elements, as you take the Holy Bible and the Holy Ghost, you begin to combine them together in perfect and equal measure. Something begins to happen. An established truth begins to take place. It is in that established truth that there is a direction of God's word. It is in that established truth, as Timothy says, study to show thyself approved, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Something happens when you take that word, you take that spirit, you put them together in equal measure, established truth begins to rise. As you begin to apply the established truth you have received, God begins to reveal himself to you. God begins to show himself to you. You know why he can do that now? Because it's not you. Because now you've got you out of the way. Now you've got flesh out of the way. Now you've taken the word and the spirit of God. Now you've crucified that carnal man. Now you brought that flesh under subjection to the spirit of God. Established truth, when applied and embraced, releases revelation. As revelation is absorbed, as you absorb revelation, as you accept it, put it into operation, apply it, transformation takes place. And once transformation begins to take place, something happens, Daryl. As you begin to take the word, you begin to take the spirit in equal measure, all of a sudden, your mind begins to change. Your heart begins to change. The spirit of God begins to come in you. The image of Christ begins to take hold of you. As that image of Christ begins to take hold of you, the voice of God becomes much clearer. The voice of God becomes more precise. And all of a sudden, you don't hear the voice of men anymore. You hear the voice of a living God in your life. Now the Bible tells us, I ain't going to get to go there tonight, but the Bible tells us, oh, thank you, Jesus. The Bible tells us, what is the spirit of Antichrist? Anybody know what that is? Bible says, he that does not confess that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is Antichrist and not of God, right? He that says that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God. Is that correct? But what is he talking about? What's he talking about? Don't you get it? Get a hold of it. Don't you see what he's saying? He's laying it out there for you. Do you know even a Satanist, even someone practicing witchcraft, believes 2,000 years ago that Jesus Christ came? That's not what he was talking about. The mystery that Paul was talking about, the mystery that he had knowledge of, the mystery of Christ, this is what was hid since the very beginning of time but is now made known. This is it, that Jesus Christ can fully, completely come alive in you. Oh, y'all ain't listening to me. Come alive in you. His word, his spirit, his power, his anointing, his authority can come alive in you. Now think about this. Think about this. The Bible says Jesus Christ, the hope of glory in you. It has to be in you. Amen. You see what I'm saying? But see, here's, think about this. You know what Satanists don't believe? You know what people in witchcraft don't believe? You know what atheists don't believe? They don't believe that Jesus can manifest in you. Oh, come on, y'all ain't hear me. They don't believe that Jesus can come alive. They don't believe that Jesus can be in his flesh. And that makes them of the spirit of Antichrist. But those that love the word, those that love the spirit, they believe that the image, the nature, the personality of Jesus Christ can manifest in you. So what Paul was telling them, he said, I've written you just a little bit. And you know I know what I'm talking about. You know I'm talking about Jesus coming alive in you. Come alive in you. You show me in that Bible where the image and nature of Jesus Christ is not supposed to come alive in you. And I'll show you 100 scriptures that dispute that every step of the way. Come on. Don't you understand? This whole walk, this whole journey is supposed to be about revelation, transformation, and manifestation. Don't you get that? It's supposed to be changing into His nature, changing into His image, thinking like Him, acting like Him, responding like Him. You can't do that without established truth, without powerful word and Spirit of God. Amen? Ooh, how many love the Lord tonight? Amen. So, when someone asks you what the mystery of Christ is, say it's that He can come alive in me. 100%. Jesus can be full in me. Jesus can manifest in me. Jesus can speak through me.
And then off in the distance you see it, rising from the rocks like a beacon of bright, shining light, warning ships, steer clear of her jagged, rocky shore.
Alas, be one of the most beautiful mornings these old sea bones have laid eyes.
I have your groceries, Captain.
What in the world is all this shouting about? Who lived back in on this place? Do you know?
Back come horses. Just a cotton pig a minute.
Time to do more than just sit on a pew and occupy space. It's time for the manifestation of Jesus Christ to come alive in your heart, mind, and soul. It's time to begin to allow that revelation to do its work. Begin to embrace the truth of that revelation. Begin to allow the Spirit to apply those principles in your life, and you'll begin to see a change. And through that transformation, manifestation will eventually come forth.
Amen.
And that's what you need, manifestation. We'll be back next week with the second part of manifestation. Now,
all right.
Now, Jenny, we just finished a great revival.
Oh, it was wonderful. Yeah. Truman Full Gospel Tabernacle with Apostle Shelby Shelton.
Yes, we were there on May 6th through the 8th. And right now, we're just going to show you a little promo from Truman.
Revival for Christ Club's Eagle Flight team is on the move and soaring to Truman, Arkansas. Experience the Holy Ghost revival and the power of God May 6th through May 8th. International president, television host, anointed author, and award-winning playwright, Chief Apostle Timothy Vanover will be ministering alongside his wife, Apostle Jenny Vanover, at Full Gospel Tabernacle Church, 17739 Arkansas Road 69 in Truman, Arkansas. For more information, please call area code 870-680-7472. That's area code 870-680-7472. Don't miss this powerful and anointed movement of God.
I thank God so much for our Truman tribe. We love our Truman people. We love our Truman folks. Sister Shelby Shelton, Jason Thomas, Pastor Chris, and Eddie LaPiro. We love all the people in Truman. They are our family, and we thank God for every one of them. Now, Jennifer, we've got something very exciting coming up. Very quickly, as a matter of fact, Apostle Jenny has been asked to speak at a very special event. It's a women's conference that's coming up. Why don't you tell us a little bit more about it?
Yes, so wonderful friend of mine, Apostle Linda Jackson, and her church is Secret Place Community Church. She will be having a two-day women conference here in Oklahoma City.
Yes,
at the Coles Conference Center on Northwest Expressway, and that's May 20th and 21st, and everyone is invited. The theme is going to be the Year of the Woman, and the scripture will be Psalms 139, Lord, you have searched me and you have known my heart.
Yes,
and I would love for everyone to come out and hear what God has to say about the Year of the Woman.
And if you'd like more information about coming out and hearing Jennifer speak at the Year of the Woman, or maybe you'd like to just have Jennifer come to your church and speak, pick up the phone and give us a call, 405-793-1777. That's 405-793-1777. Or you can write us P.O. Box 777 Moore, Oklahoma 73153. That's P.O. Box 777 Moore, Oklahoma 73153. And so don't miss that. The Year of the Woman coming up, May 20th through the 21st.
Yes, absolutely. And I now believe this is, I will be speaking Friday night about 7, and I'll be speaking Saturday afternoon, somewhere around 2, and I would just love to share the Word of God with all of you.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, now, Jennifer, we've got a number coming up by the Mariah Dance Company.
Yes.
And this is one of my favorites. Why don't you announce and tell everybody what this is?
Okay, so this is choreographed by Priscilla Fowler, and I'm proud of the Mariah Dance Company, a Christian dance company, uplifting God with their talents. Right now we present Ghost.
Ghost is a fire, a holy flame burning wild, burning through the night, burning with the light of a billion stars. His love is like lightning, cracking through the sky. Burning through the rage, burning through the pain of a billion scars. Get ready. Get ready. Get ready. Get ready. All the stories are true. Ghost is inside me, holy fire burning wild, burning through the things that need to be erased to liberate my soul. Get ready, there's an red, even mountains move. Get red.
Lord. God bless you. Thanks so much for tuning in on our 100th episode. Here's our cake, and we're going to have a celebration. Light it up, Jenny, down here, babe.
Oh.
Woo!
Yay!
Woo! Our 100th episode. Everybody come in here and help
Yay!
Us celebrate. 100 episodes, a lot of our crew, a lot of our staff. Thank you guys so much. Thank you guys for tuning in. Thank you guys for supporting. Thank those of you who have been with us and stood beside us. We truly appreciate it. God bless you. We hope to see you next week right here at this same time every Monday and Thursday at 10 o'clock on the Mighty CFAN when you'll see Revival for Christ Club. We know our God has something great for you. Woo!
Oh, and I love you. You're my love.
Special for you.
Ooh, baby, special for you.
Woo!
Oh! It kissed me.
Woo.
Outro take one. Mark.
Special for you. Whoa.
I got you.
Oh, yeah. You can talk. Hey, Chip, you can talk about that. When we know our God has something fabulous for you.
Ooh, oh my. I love you. I love you.
Okay. Let's not put that on there. We know our God has something special for you.
Ooh.
Oh, baby, that hurts my back, don't it? Don't fall on the floor.
You can't leave your girl on the floor. Good night.
Oh, happy birthday to you. May you find every day of it. Happy birthday to you. Oh, happy birthday to you. Be the best that you've ever had.
If we say that, Jimmy has to dance like that on camera.
You.
And that's a wrap.
My name is Ryan Colley. I'm the Administrative Vice President and International Evangelist of Revival for Christ Club International Ministries. We'd like to thank you so much for tuning into our program today. And if you would like to ignite the flame in your area, we would love to bring the love of Jesus to you. All you got to do is reach out to us by phone at 405-793-1777. You can also reach out to us on Facebook by direct message at Revival for Christ Club International Ministries or on YouTube. Also, if you would like to help us spread the flame around the world, you can do it in so many different ways. First off, you can do it through our Cash App. That's RFC Roar. That's money sign RFC R-O. AR. Also, you can do credit card by phone at 405-793-1777. Now, once again, that's 405-793-1777. And finally, you can mail your support to 1005 Southwest 4th Street, Moore, Oklahoma, 73160. Once again, we'd like to thank everybody for tuning into our program today. Remember, we are a ministry with a vision built on a plan, the Word of God.